Please remain standing and join with me in the call to worship. I will tell God's story to family and friends. I will offer praise in the center of the congregation. Because God has never turned away from our suffering or hidden away when we are in need. To our great comfort, I raise my voice in praise.
You may be seated. Let us pray. God of all creation, in this season of thanksgiving for the harvests of the earth, we are struck by the beauties of autumn leaves and bright colors, birds flying south in formation, fields ripe with produce. Such beauty speaks of your goodness, your desire to provide what each beloved creature needs. As we gather this day, renew our sense of thanksgiving for what you give to us in the fruitfulness of creation and in Christ Jesus, who teaches us how to walk wisely on the earth you made. For all your good gifts, we honor you with thanks and praise now and always. Amen.
Once, daunted by the challenges of faithfulness, Jesus' disciples asked urgently, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and he said, "For humans it is impossible, but not for God. All things are possible for God." Trusting in God who belongs to mend our broken places, let us turn to God in prayer. And now, if you'll please join me in the prayer of confession as printed in our bulletin. Holy God, sometimes it hurts too much to look honestly at the world and ourselves. We grow tired of the constant bad news, so that we put on a brave face and gloss over the aches of violence, sickness, disaster, and human callousness that plagues our globe. With those we are closest to, we sometimes pretend that we feel okay, that we are not worried, that we have a plan. We even lie to ourselves, not fully admitting the impact of our actions on one another or ourselves. Forgive us, O God, when we try to hide our hearts from you. Fuel our trust that we might approach you with our full selves, authentic in our gifts and our fears and our shortcomings. Give us the courage to walk together through the trials of life, rather than struggling on alone. And help us to sense your faithful presence through the days when it feels like there is more shadow than sun. The Lord is compassionate and merciful, very patient and full of faithful love. As high as heaven is above the earth, that's how large God's faithful love is for God's children. As far as east is from west, that's how far God has removed our sin from us.
Would the young people and whoever else would like to come forward, come on up and sit with me on the steps. Good morning. Whoa, that was loud. Have any of you ever heard of a TV program? It's a game show called Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? I don't even know, is it still on TV? That's been a while since I've seen it. And
you know, it's kind of a quiz show, trivia questions that are asked. And each time the people guess or give the correct answer, they go up a little higher in the amount of money that they can win. And they can quit any time and keep what they've won so far, or they can continue going, but if they get a wrong answer, then they lose everything. But if they answer all the questions, what happens? What do they win? $1 million. $1 million. Would you like to be a millionaire? Nowadays, we don't even talk about millionaires as much as we talk about billionaires. Can you imagine having $1 billion? Well, a famous comedian, her name is Sophie Tucker, once said, "I've been rich and I've been poor. Believe me, rich is better." I wonder what Jesus would have to say about that. One day, Jesus was walking along and a young man came running up to him and said, "Good teacher, what must I do to have eternal life?" And Jesus said, "Well, you know the commandments. Do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not testify falsely, do not cheat, honor your father and your mother." And the young man said, "Well, I've obeyed those commandments since I was a child." Well, the Bible says that Jesus looked at the young man and he loved him. And he said to him, "You lack only one thing. Sell all you have and give the money to the poor, so that you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me." And what do you think that young man did? Any ideas? He sadly turned away. He walked away from Jesus because he had many possessions. Then Jesus looked at his disciples and he said, "How hard it is for rich people to get into the kingdom of God." Well, the disciples were shocked, and Jesus said, "It is very hard to get into the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God." And then Peter asked, "Then who in the world can be saved?" And Jesus said, "With man it is impossible, but not with God. All things are possible with God." So why was the rich man unable to enter the kingdom? Because he wouldn't give up his money. He wouldn't give up his riches. His love for money and for things was greater than his love for God. And if anyone wants to enter the kingdom of God, they have to give God first place in their life. Let's pray. Dear Father, remind us that you are and should be the number one priority in our lives. Other things are nice and helpful, but our love for you should be the most important. In Jesus we pray. Amen. Thank you. He's staring at me. Yeah, hi, yes, you were smiling. Hi.
Let the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord. Be our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Our first scripture reading this morning is from Hebrews chapter 4, verses 12 through 16. Indeed, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And before him, no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us, therefore, approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Our second reading this morning is from Mark chapter 10, verses 17 through 31. As he was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before him, and he asked, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and your mother." And he said to him, "Teacher, I have kept all of these since my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him, and he said, "You lack one thing. Go, sell what you own, and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." When he heard this, he was shocked, and he went away grieving, for he had many possessions. Then Jesus looked around, and he said to the disciples, "How hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." And the disciples were perplexed by these words. But Jesus said to them again, "Children, how hard is it to enter the kingdom of God? It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of the needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." They were greatly astounded, and they said to one another, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them, and he said, "For mortals it is impossible, but not for God. For God all things are possible." Peter began to say to him, "Look, we have left everything and followed you." Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for my sake and for the sake of the good news, who will not receive 100-fold now in this age: houses, brothers and sisters, mothers and children, and fields with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first." This is the word of the Lord.
When I was a sophomore in high school, I was cast in the musical play Fiddler on the Roof. I didn't get the main role of Tevye, the lead character who, with his wife Golda, was trying to raise five daughters. However, my character did get to marry one of the daughters. Now, Tevye was a poor Jewish milkman struggling with cultural and political changes that seemed to be replacing the old traditional ways. At one point in the story, he dreams about what it might be like to be rich, and he sings the song, "If I Were a Rich Man." Every time I read or hear this morning's passage from Mark's Gospel, it always reminds me of that song, "If I Were a Rich Man." Before he begins singing, he says to God, "Oh Lord, you made many, many poor people. I realize, of course, it's no shame to be poor, but it's no great honor either. So what would have been so terrible if I had just a small fortune?" And then he sings about a big house with three staircases, one going up and one coming down and one more going nowhere just for show. He dreams of a yard filled with noisy poultry and his wife Golda ordering around the servants. He sings about being well respected by the other men of the village and spending his day studying the holy books with the learned men at the temple. At the end of the song, he addresses God once again. "Lord, who made the lion and the lamb, you decreed I should be what I am. Would it spoil some vast eternal plan if I were a wealthy man?" Well, in the end, he realizes that although he is not rich financially, he is rich with family and friends. Of course, the desire to be rich and popular doesn't occur only in fictional stories. When my son was in high school and I asked his friends what they wanted to be when they grew up, you know what they all said? Rich. Listen to the following description of a real person, or like real people. Maybe you know someone like him or her. "He's quite rich. He wears Italian shoes and tailored suits. His money is invested. He carries platinum credit cards. He lives like he flies first class. He's young. Energy is his trademark, and death is an eternity away. He's powerful." If you don't think so, just ask him. "You got questions? He's got answers. You got problems? He's got solutions. You got dilemmas? He's got opinions. He knows where he's going, and he'll be there by tomorrow. He's the new generation, so the old had better pick up the pace or pack their bags. Who is he? Who is she? The top salesman of his district making it up the corporate ladder? She's the rising lawyer who just became the youngest partner at her prestigious law firm. He's the successful real estate broker who has more listings than he can handle, except that he can handle them all just fine. In the Bible, he is the rich young man. Until today, life for him has been like a walk in the park. But then he runs into Jesus, and he has one question. What's in it for me, and what do I have to do to get it?" Of course, it isn't only the rich young man, or the rich and the powerful, the upwardly mobile, who are enamored with tangible rewards. Here's another person, quite different in some ways, but not in all ways. He is called by God. He's gifted. He serves as an elder and a Sunday school teacher. He knows the Bible and he shares his faith. He's a true man of prayer. He's raising his family in the faith. He is a disciple of Jesus Christ. That is what people think, and that is the truth. But he is also a struggler. He struggles with one question: what's in it for me? Since I have given you so much, O God, what can I get in return? I want health. I could use more money. I just want my kids to turn out all right. I want to retire early. Who is he? Well, he's every Christian who has come to think of his relationship with God as a deal. I will give you my life, Lord, but what do I get in return? To some degree, he is probably all of us who have left all to follow Christ, pastors included. In the Bible, he is Peter. Peter began to say to him, "Look, we've left everything and followed you." Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for my sake and for the sake of the good news who will not receive 100-fold in this age, houses, brothers and sisters, mothers and children and fields with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first." A little Freudian slip there. Shared by both the young man, the rich young man, and Peter, and maybe even us, is the question, what's in it for me? But rather than asking the question, what's in it for me, we should be asking ourselves the question, what am I willing to sacrifice to be a true follower of Jesus? And I'm not talking about just money, but also time. Some people know Bob as a guy who is generous with his money. It's not that he's public about it. He's helped out quite a few folks in very quiet ways. Bob's church put out an appeal for help for hurricane survivors. And Bob, he gave half his salary for the month. An old friend comes by on a regular basis, and Bob always pulls out his wallet. The guy has fallen on hard times. At Christmas, Bob responds to every request for money from an agency he respects. He gives money for toys, food, emergency aid, and funds a Christmas party for the nursing home down the street. But even though Bob has plenty of spare time, he is retired, and is in great health, he never responds to requests for volunteering. He has said no to helping at the Christmas party, to delivering meals, to working a fundraiser for the hurricane survivors. He even avoids conversations with the friend who always needs money. Bob's point of view is that he doesn't have to give his time because he gives his money. He has his own pursuits and interests, and he just likes having his time at his own disposal without demands from others. Writing a check is easy, but giving up a Saturday? That's another thing altogether. When Jesus encountered the man in today's story, Mark tells us Jesus looked at him and loved him. He was one of us, our neighbor, our co-worker, our fellow churchgoer. He was us. He was a normal guy, a very good guy who was happy with his life. "Is there anything lacking?" he asked. I think he knew that what was lacking. He seemed to be faithful in so many ways, but Jesus told him to keep the commandments. "Well, I do all that," he said eagerly. "You know what's required," said Jesus, loving him. "What's the one thing you have trouble giving up?" "Give up your money," said Jesus. "Give away all of it to the poor." "All of it?" he gasped. "All of it." The young man was shocked. Absolutely shocked. It was impossible to imagine that after all he had done for God, there would be this one enormous, unreasonable thing asked of him. And when he realized that Jesus was serious, he walked away. He grieved because he could not believe this would be required of him. He wanted to do all for God, but this was just a little too much. This was over the edge. Gosh, maybe Jesus wasn't from God after all. The God he knew would not require such a thing. Possessions are blessings, aren't they? Jesus watched this man and loved him. And the disciples watched, slack-jawed. If this is true, then who in the world can get into the kingdom of God? With God's smile, Jesus, all things are possible. And as he looked at his disciples, he loved them. Each of us, no matter how faithful we are, have the potential to hold something back. We have the potential of keeping one corner of our hearts hidden from God, or so we think. We have the potential to love one thing too much to allow God to use it, because we believe that only we know how best it should be used. We have the potential of letting that one thing, no matter how small, grow in importance to such an extent that it eclipses our faithfulness. But we also have the potential of learning to let go. We all have the potential of making small beginnings to be more faithful and more open to God and others. How? Because all things are possible with God. But even if we are shocked by what God is asking us to sacrifice, even if we turn away in sadness and grief, Jesus looks after us, and he loves us. One of the tasks that I perform as a transitional pastor is to present a time and talent survey to the congregation. It will list the volunteer opportunities currently available, but it will also include a space for you to suggest new ministries for which you are particularly passionate. Along with your financial support of the church, I encourage you to prayerfully consider other ways in which you may serve God with your time and your talents. We could never repay God for all that God has done for us, and thankfully, God doesn't require that of us. However, giving of our time, our money, and our talents are tangible ways in which we can express our gratitude for all God has done for us. Amen.
The sparrows not worried about tomorrow, or the troubles to come. The lilies not thinking about the seasons, the drought or the flood. The tree that's planted by the water isn't fazed by the fire. So why should I be? 'Cause you take good care of me. You take the sun's not worried about the winter, 'cause soon it will pass. The light's not thinking about the darkness or the shadow it casts. A heart that's planted in forgiveness doesn't dwell in the past. So why should I be? 'Cause you take good care. Take good care of me. You know what? past your kindness. I know there's got to be more, but I can't get past your goodness. I know there must be more, but I can't get past your kindness. I know there's got to be more, but I can't get past your goodness. You take good care of me. You take good care of me. You know what I need before I even ask a thing. You hold me in your hands with a kindness that never ends. I'm carried in your love no matter what the future brings. Oh, you take good care of me.
Let us go to God in prayer. God of infinite patience and wisdom, we come to you with so many things that claim our time, our energy, our resources, our very lives. We are easily drawn away from serving you by the enticements of the world for wealth, ease, and comfort. Just like the young man in the scriptures, we are owned by our possessions, held captive by our treasures. You continue to offer us healing and hope. You seek to transform our lives from captivity to freedom in witness and service. We look at the world in which there is so very much warfare and strife, anger and hatred, and we easily become overwhelmed by the needs and the stresses. Help us to place our lives and our trust in you, knowing that with your help, many wonderful things can be accomplished which will provide peace and hope for others and for ourselves. Give us courage and strength to truly be your disciples. For we ask this in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The offering box is in the narthex. If you have not had an opportunity to place your offering yet in the box, we encourage you to do so following worship. Even in the midst of our darkest days and deepest longings, we are assured of the presence of God. In gratitude for our God, who is big enough to hold our loving praise and our cries of woe, let us offer signs of our thanks with the gifts of our time, our talent, and our treasures. Let us pray. Gracious God, all that we have is yours. Accept these gifts, signs of our gratitude, as we return them to you. Show us how to use them that they may point to your abiding love, which is our eternal hope. In Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. And our final hymn comes to us from... in our hymnal, number 444, I love to tell the story, 444. Please stand as you are able. You have been made free by the love of God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Go into the world to serve God by helping others. Be at peace and bring God's love and peace with you wherever you go. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forever. Amen.